come out, come visit us. And I was talking with Rick a little earlier. I am clammy right now. The hands are clammy. And this morning I asked him, I told him I was listening to a message of his a while back he did out of Ephesians. He made mention that he's always nervous when he comes up to the pulpit. It doesn't matter. It happens. And I asked, is it still not on?
He's on.
It's green.
Okay. Go get it.
Okay. All right. So, but anyway, I was asking, you know, still nervous. Yeah, it still happens. That's why. And then what happened? 45 minutes later, after you're supposed to be up, you finally get up. And so that's what it felt like this today. You guys kept singing, man. I'm sitting there, I'm like, I'm ready to go. 6 o'clock, let's just do this, let's get it over. Because, like, what, 30 minutes? Probably could have been done by now. So, but, no, it's all right. It's still a lot of fun to see you guys. Dez took off already, right? Dez gave me some great ideas. So what's his new company name? Real quick.
Thruly
Furnished. That's a pretty neat name. So he's doing car interiors, Thruly Furnished. Ben's got Master's Touch. Maybe think about changing my company name, you know, JJ Prop. I was thinking, you know, kind of neat. You know, got paint, Whited Sepulcher. I think that'd be a good name, wouldn't it? Yeah. Yeah, I guess not, huh? Anyhow, let's move along. All right, get a couple jokes in. Once you hit that bad one, you got to stop, right, Rick? All right. All right. So we're going to get over to 2 Timothy here, 2 Timothy chapter 1. Now, I was given verses 9 to 12, but I went ahead and took 8 as well. And so let's go ahead and we'll start reading there. 2 Timothy 1, verse number 8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who had saved us and called us with a holy calling. Called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which has been given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I believe, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Let's pray. Dear Father, I just want to thank you for this time to get together, just a bunch of saints going over your word, just being edified, just learning what you have for us, that we may take it out in the real world and be able to further the gospel and be able to show people the grace that we have in our life that we got from you and what it can do. And we just pray that during this time we will be edified, and we can take these things and apply them in our life. In your name, amen. All right. So we look at 2 Timothy, and I think after we've had, can you still hear me when I walk away from the pulpit?
All right, sweet. Yeah.
All right, so the message is this week, we've learned kind of the background, what's going on. Paul's in prison and 2 Timothy, is he not? And he's writing to Timothy, and Timothy's got some issues going on. And what's starting to happen with Timothy when we read in verse 8? He's saying, be not what? Be not ashamed, right? So Timothy, we see that Timothy's starting to get ashamed about some stuff. And Paul felt the need that he's going to have to write him to go ahead and tell him not to be ashamed. When you look at the word ashamed, there's that embarrassment. What does Webster say? Embarrassed or guilty because of one's actions. See, my wife has been ashamed of me a lot, you know, because of my actions, right? You're joking around. I kid, love her. All right, but it could be your characteristics or even your associations. You could be ashamed of even the associations that you make, right? It's also, when you're ashamed, you're reluctant to do something, you know, because of possible embarrassment or humility. And so why is Timothy ashamed in 2 Timothy 1? Well, Paul tells you. Don't be ashamed of what? The testimony of our Lord. And what's the second thing? I'm sorry. I do. I was looking for a response, especially a small group. We can be open. But the other thing is what is that Paul's what? Paul's in prison, right? So you have an apostle who's in prison. You have the testimony that for whatever reason doesn't seem to be spreading. So, but Paul tells him in verse 12, what? For these cause I suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am what? I'm not ashamed. So Paul's not ashamed about what's going on. And why is that? So let's look at verse 9. We're going to read verse 9, 10, and 11 again here. Paul says, you know, who had saved us, being God. God had saved us and called us with what? A holy calling. not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which has been given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed a preacher. So Paul looks at this and he says, what's the first thing? God did what for us? He saved us. Did he not? Turn over to Romans 3. Timothy's being ashamed of this testimony. In Romans 3, we look at this. Romans 3, let's look at verse 23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God had set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. What is the testimony that we have? It has anything to do with us. Are we saved because of anything that we've done, any good that's in us? No. We're saved because of what? Because of Christ's righteousness, right? And what Christ had done in him and his faithfulness. And God says that he is now just, but he's also the justifier of them that believe it in the Lord. Right? Is that what we hear a lot today? We hear that your salvation is because of what the Lord had done, and that's it, and you put your faith in what he had done for you? No, you hear a lot of what? Well, you got to repent, right? Turn and burn! You know, you got to, what is it, win them, wet them, whip them, work them. There's this whole religious system built around getting you to perform so this way that you know that you're saved. We go through, we take a look at Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. We know that. You don't have to turn there. You know, for by grace are we saved through faith, that not of ourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. The religious system wants to boast in what they're doing and what they have. And Paul's saying there's none of that when it comes to Christ. None of that when it comes to the testimony of our Lord. Think about our vocation. What is our calling, that holy calling that we have? Think about 2 Corinthians 5. You turn over there real quick. Take a look. I told Rick earlier, I was like, yeah, the first 10 minutes still feels like a car wreck, so I might mess up the quote, so we're just going to turn there and look at it. But 2 Corinthians 5, and verse number 18, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto him, and committed to us the word of reconciliation. We are now ambassadors. We go out, we have this message for people. Be ye reconciled unto God. Here, this is what he did. It has nothing to do with you. But what does the religious system today tell you? Are we ambassadors, or are we a royal priesthood? Are we a holy nation? You start to see where Timothy now, with the people that are he's around, or even take for us, where we can start to be ashamed, right? Where people want to make us feel ashamed. What are you doing? What is this that you believe? You have to go out and you have to do things. You have to perform. The religious system wants you to feel ashamed, so you do what? Be quiet. Interesting that Paul makes mention of himself, right? How many people, you think about that, how many times people say, oh, you guys worship Paul? Anybody ever tell you that? Or somebody gets really spiritual on you, and I love it. I just got this one question for you, brother. Did Paul die for your sins, or did Christ? And you're like, yep, you know nothing. We look at Paul. Paul in Romans 11, he says that what? He's the apostle of the Gentiles, and he what? Magnifies his office. It's an office that was given to him. Same thing, Moses was given a specific office. Paul was given a specific office. We're not glorifying the man, but we're recognizing his position and what the Lord had given him for this dispensation of grace. And think about 2 Timothy 2:15. Just in relation to being ashamed, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that what? If you don't rightly divide, what do you need to be? No, if you don't rightly divide, You need to be ashamed. There's something wrong with your doctrine. You need to be humiliated in that fact. You need to walk away from that. That's some stinking thinking, I think is what Alex would say. All right. Let's move on. So when we're looking at this, back over to 2 Timothy chapter 1. Paul again And verse 12 says, "For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed." So why is it that when we preach these things, we still can feel that shame aspect? Where's that shame? Why would Timothy still feel that shame? I'm going to go out on a limb here. Y'all can beat me with that limb later if you like. But when you look at... No, not funny, huh? All right, so verse 8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor me as prisoner, but be thou what? Partaker of the afflictions of the gospel, according to the power of God. It's interesting. It's like if you're not going to be ashamed, you're going to be a partaker of something. But if you're not going to partake, chances are you're becoming ashamed. And there's something that's in there. When you look at that, can you have, when we talk about Paul's confidence that he had, that he can say that I'm not ashamed. Why? I think because he's been through all the lickings that there is. And he can show us how you cannot be ashamed by being partakers of those. You guys following me? If not, we're going to leave you behind. All right. So now we have this apostle, right? We have this apostle who's going to be what for us? He's our example. Go over to 1 Timothy 1:16. I even wrote down the wrong verse. I wrote Romans 1:16. 1 Timothy 1:16. "Howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy..." I'll start in 15. "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Christ Jesus might show forth all long suffering, for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to everlasting life." Guess what? We got our leadoff man, right? We got the first guy up to bat who's going to go and see what this pitcher's got. Paul's going to go ahead and he's going to pave that path. And unfortunately, it says what? "Show forth all long suffering." He's got a long road ahead of him. But he's going to be that example for us. He's the one that we're going to look to, because the Lord says he's going to be that pattern. He's the one that he's going to display all this stuff in. Go over to 2 Corinthians 1. 2 Corinthians 1. I think what's great about the Lord is that, yeah, he did give Paul to us as that example, but he didn't leave Paul alone to go figure out how to be that example. And just the same that he won't leave us alone in that while we're also learning how to follow Paul as that example. I hope that came across correctly. If not, we should be able to pick that up here in 2 Corinthians 1. In verse number 3, "Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all comfort, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ. And whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same sufferings which we suffer. Or whether you be comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as you are partakers of the suffering, so you shall also be of the consolation." All right. What is consolation? You look at that and you have your brother's hurt and you're going to go ahead and you're going to do what? You're going to console them, right? You're going to speak soft words, loving words to them in hopes that they will be comforted. You give the consolation. Does that mean they're going to be comforted? No. But if they receive that consolation, it becomes comfort. And so when we look here in verse number 6, what's interesting about this is that Paul says that we're going to be that example, right? And whether we be afflicted, it's for what? It's for your consolation. So you're starting to see when Paul's getting beat or when he's going through persecutions, he's going through tribulations, you see that, hey, that's for your consolation. And when Paul's comforted, that's also for your consolation. Basically, get a notepad, write it down, start to understand, okay, hey, there's something going on here. Look at Paul as our pattern. What is he doing? How is he living? How is he responding to these things that are going on? Paul says it is effectual. Once again, effectual means what? not to be replaced, not to be substituted for, not to be built upon it. It's perfect the way that it is. Don't change it. Same thing over in 2 Timothy 2:13, right? It is effectual. The Word of God is effectual, right? In building you up. He's saying here that this is the effectual and the same enduring that I have. So pay attention to what's going on. Don't try to replace it. If I decided that in my own doing, you think about what? I'm trying to think of how to put it here. If I'm suffering, right, and I decide that the Lord says, hey, you know, turn the other cheek. Of course, he said that to somebody else. But anyway, if you turn the other cheek, and if I decide, no, you know what, I'm going to punch a dude, and I'm going to go after him, I'm now rejecting that consolation. Now that comfort is gone. I am no longer doing what? I'm no longer being partaker of that affliction. I'm no longer sitting here and saying, okay, I'm going to believe what the Lord had said and how I'm going to move forward. I'm going to go ahead and do it on my own. See, in verse 8 and 9, go over there. For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out above measure, above strength, insomuch that we even despaired life. But we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not, what? Trust in ourselves. Paul was able to apply the consolation from the Lord during those situations that he came to an end result, which was what? Don't trust in your own flesh. If I take the consolation from the Lord and I receive that as that comfort, I've just come to realize it. Like verse 9, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raises the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver. You see the beauty? See, the Lord said, hey, I'm going to be your consolation in this. Just listen, believe, sit down, shut up, and believe what I'm telling you. And you're going to start to learn stuff from it. And that's where Paul learned not to trust in himself. All right. Over in, scooch down to verse number 12 now. Paul says, for our rejoicing is this, that the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we've had our conversation in the world, and more abundantly toward you. You think about that. We've had our conversation is in the world. By what? By the grace of God. Go back to 2 Timothy real quick. 2 Timothy 1. By the grace of God, and we're told, you know, by a lot of stuff that in our life, you know, we give thanks by the grace of God. How we deal with people, we deal with them through that grace. 2 Timothy 1. Once again, verse 8. Go to the second half. But be thou partakers of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. You sit there, you imagine the grace of God and how that mindset Paul would have had in living out the grace of God is also part of that power of God. Grab second, I think 2 Corinthians 12 and 2 Corinthians 4 will help show this a little clearer. 2 Corinthians 12. I'm going to slow down just a second here. 2 Corinthians 12 and 2 Corinthians 4. 2 Corinthians 12. We're going to look at verse number 7. Now I'm aware these verses, we've seen them plenty of times, but I think it's good that we continually go over them and we take a look at them and revisit them in verse 7. Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me. Lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that I may depart me. So three times, Paul had asked, hey, let it go. And he says, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Hold this spot. Go over to 2 Corinthians 4. And look in verse 7. But we have this treasure. Yeah, that's right. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. You go back over to 2 Corinthians 12. The second half of verse 9. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmity, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. You have this aspect. You have Paul's talking about he is strong, and he takes pleasure when he is weak. He lets the power of God rest upon him, right? He's going to go ahead. How is he now going to go through the turmoil, the persecution? What is he going to use? Is he going to use his own fleshly wisdom? Is he going to use his own strength? What is he going to reside on? It is going to be, waiting for an answer. It's going to be the power of Christ. It's going to be the power of God. It's the power of God that he's going to use to get through these issues. And so when you look at, when you're going back through here, Paul, rephrase it. Paul is noticing that here in 2 Corinthians 12, that the life that he has is not his own, that it needs to be Christ's life living through him. It's his grace is going to be sufficient for him. He's going to take pleasure in those infirmities and reproaches and persecution and distress for Christ's sake, for when he is weak, then he is strong. He now becomes strong when he is dead, because he is doing what? Who is he letting be magnified in his body? He's letting Christ be magnified in his body. 2 Timothy 1:8. Be thou partaker of the affliction of the gospel according to what? The power of God. The power of God is telling Paul what in these afflictions is to allow who to be him, be his life, to be manifested in him. The Christ, let the life of Christ now be manifested in you. I do believe that the power of God is also his word. I mean, you can't separate the two. When you sit there and you read his word, that's what's going to give you the strength and you're going to grow in it. But he's saying, let his life be made manifest in you. That is the power of God to get you through these tribulations, through these persecutions. Get over to Philippians 1. I'd say, though, it's pretty amazing, though, when you look at that, you take up those afflictions, and you're allowing it to be Christ magnified in your life. What happened to that shame? I mean, it's no longer you. That shame is going to disappear. It's not about you and what's going on in your life, but it's about him and what he's doing. In Philippians 1:20, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed. Here it is again. Paul in prison, being persecuted, things going on, and he's hoping that nothing's going to be ashamed, but that what? With all boldness, as always, so now also Christ may be magnified in my body. He wants to see that. He wants the aspect of the Lord living in him through every one of his circumstances. He doesn't want it to be about him. Verse 21, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain, but I live in the flesh as the fruit of my labor. He does not want the fruit of his own labor, does he? But there's something else that's going on in here. When Paul is allowing Christ to be in his life, so this way he can endure those afflictions, a couple other things are going on here. Look at verse 1. One's in verse 28. All right. And in, starting 27, only let your conversations become of the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. That you stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for one faith, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries. Again, so if you're ashamed, you're going to be what? You're going to be terrified. But here he's, what's going on? You're not terrified. Why? Because it's not, once again, it's not about you. You are learning now that you're going to be a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel. And what is that again? It's you taking on Christ's life and allowing those things to happen without letting your flesh get in the way. You're going to go through and you're going to witness. Someone's going to hate you, going to beat you up, is going to talk bad about you. You're going to go back and, you know, little fisticuffs? No. You're going to go ahead and you're going to respond the way that Christ would have you respond. Richard, a couple weeks ago, he was on this passage. You can probably listen to his message. He probably did a little bit better job than me, just a little bit. 2 Corinthians 6. He gives you a list. We're going to hold here because I got that second point I got to make in Philippians. But in 2 Corinthians 6, you can look at what a lot of these persecutions are. And he says that in verse number 3, give no offense. Here we go. Once again, allowing Christ to be magnified. We don't want to, if we give offense, he's not being magnified in our body. Give no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. But in all things, approving ourselves as ministers of God, in much patience, afflictions, and necessities, and in distresses, and stripes, and imprisonments, and tumults, and labors, and watchings, and fastings. By pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love and fame, by the word of truth, by the power of God, for the armor of righteousness on the left and on the right. You see, all these things, but it all depends about how we're going to have, what mindset do we have. Are we going to have the mind of Christ through this, or are we going to go ahead and we're going to have the mind of a, you know, as a personal warrior, that we're going to go ahead and it's going to be about us. Back to Philippians. So here, Philippians 1, verse 28, these guys are no longer terrified. That is, I think that's awesome. You allow Christ to be magnified in your life. You help to get to squelch that, to get rid of that. But there's something else that's bigger that's going on. And this is where I think where Paul is really driving it. And hopefully this, if anything, starts to be clear. Verse 12. But I would, you should understand, brethren, that the things which have happened unto me have fallen out rather to the what? Furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in the Christ are manifest in all the palace and all other places. And many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. What's going on? These guys are now becoming shameless. There's no shame in them. Their confidence is now like, they got some serious confidence going on. The gospel is now spreading. Well, Ben, we were talking earlier, you know, back in the early, what was it? Was it 1100s? With the persecution and how the gospel was transferring. Brian Ross did a whole big series on it and how the Bible got here and got over there. You know how it spread all across into Europe? You know how it got there? Persecution. People being killed, going after them. And what happened? These guys, these saints were like, no, we got to keep it going. And the Bible kept getting further. It got spread out more and more. People were more bold to speak up and do what needed to be done. So saints like us today can have that truth. So what happened to Paul? You sit here and you look at this, and honestly, I think Paul became a junkie. I think he became like a tribulation junkie. You might laugh at that, but go over to Colossians 1. He is starting to see this pattern that's going on with the comfort, the consolation, the afflictions, and letting Christ be magnified in my body. Yeah, getting beaten down, and all of a sudden, the furtherance of the gospel. And Paul's starting to see all this, and how this is all starting to work, and what's going on. He's starting to buy into it. He's starting to realize, you know what? Let's do this. You know, bring it on. What else is there? What else is lacking? What else do I need to help you all grow? Come on, Lord. You know, you said all long suffering. I think there might be some stuff that's lacking. Colossians 1:24, who now rejoice in my sufferings for you and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church, why I'm made a minister. Paul is looking for it now. I'm not saying he's actively going out there as a masochist or anything like that, but it's kind of like, it's slightly odd that that's what he wants now. What else? What else can I do that benefits you guys? Because when I benefit you, I benefit everybody. And that gospel is going to get out and it's going to get spread and guys are going to become bolder. Go over to Philippians 3. And to me, Paul even goes further now than this. And it's fun to try to wrap your mind around it. And for me, it's experience. I'm never going to experience what Paul experienced. I'm at the pulpit telling you guys, hey, this is what Paul did. Can you imagine Paul, though? You read it. He went through every single one of these things. And the relationship he had with the Lord, verse 9, all right, Philippians 3:9, and being found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness of God, which is of faith, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, be made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection. Not as that I already had attained, were I already perfect, but I fall after, that I might apprehend that which I was, apprehend that for which I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Paul wants resurrection life now. How can I get it? Do I need to suffer more? How do I become more conformable unto your death? Is it by afflictions? Is it by going out? Is it still being, you know, sacrificed in the service of your faith? Whatever it's going to be to get me there, he was going to get there, or get him there. He wanted to be there. And so now when you look back at 2 Timothy, and you see Paul saying, for I am nevertheless, I am not ashamed. You start to see why he wasn't ashamed. Bring on the persecutions. All it's going to do is make everything so much better. It sounds really weird. But bring it on, because things are better for the gospel. Things are better for you, for people getting saved. Let's do this. Don't be ashamed, Timothy. Don't worry about it. It's all good. For this light affliction, right? We got so much better. Got something so much better coming up. Just take this light affliction. Don't worry about it. It's good stuff. Eat it. Get beat. Let's go get beat for Christ. Romans 5:3. Paul goes on. Romans 5:3. I'm getting there? What's that mean? The jokes are recognized? Okay. You know, hey, the car wreck's over. If the car wreck lasted a little longer, it was about 20 minutes this time, and I'm sitting there, I'm like, ah. So when my wife and Stacy are trying not to make eye contact, I know things aren't good. So Romans 5:3. Ray's sweet. Ray's back there. He's like, come on, Joseph, come on. You can do it. All right, Romans 5:3. And not only so, but we also glory in tribulations. Here we are. We're glorying now in tribulations, right? I don't have those tribulations. I can't glory in those yet. But I can see how Paul would. Knowing, and this is, I love this part, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh what? Ah, delightful. Makes us not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given us. You look at that pattern there, and that is exactly the opposite of what the world does. Exactly. He says that tribulation worketh what? Patience. What does the world say? Tribulation worketh what? Well, it can work death. It definitely can work death, because I can't handle this. I'm gone, right? But also, they're saying, hey, when you're going through hard times, man, you're going to get that experience you're going to need. And then when you get that experience, you can get the patience. Is that what it says? It says tribulation worketh experience? No, it's patience first. Aha, sit down, shut up, believe the verse, right? Here's your consolation. Are you going to make it comfort, or are you going to go out on your own? Because you can't put the cart before the horse. Make sure I don't mess that one up. Like Ben the other day, and life from death to life. Or anyhow, so when you look at this, you need to actually have that patience before the experience will ever come. So let's glory in those tribulations, knowing that we have that consolation. Now let's make that our comfort, that Christ can be magnified in our bodies. I love this one. Jeremiah 9. I grabbed Jeremiah 9 and 1 Corinthians 1, and we're going to end them. We're going to end them here. Jeremiah 9, and just the very end of 1 Corinthians 1. All right. Jeremiah 9, verse 23. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him that glory... Let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understandeth and knoweth me, that I am the Lord, which exercise loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. What are we supposed to, what is he telling them that they're supposed to glory in? Glory in what? That you knoweth him. You understand the Lord. You know him and you understand what he's going to be doing. 1 Corinthians 1. Verse number 29. Interestingly enough, verse 25, he talks about the wiser and the stronger man too, just like over in Jeremiah. But verse 29, that no flesh should glory in his presence, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according to it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. We know him, we understand him. Who is the Lord to us? It says it right there, he's our wisdom, he's our righteousness, our sanctification, our redemption. We understand him. We understand the process he's using. That's when Paul says in 2 Timothy, I can't even get there. It'd be great if I could just get there. I'm trying to find it. Verse 12, for the which cause I suffer these things, nevertheless I am not ashamed. For I know whom I've believed. I know him. I understand him. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed against. He is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Know the Lord. I know you know what he's going to do through these situations. Don't be ashamed. Take that opportunity to allow that work through. That was Paul's confidence. Because he knew this. He knew what the Lord was planning on doing. Interestingly enough, you talk about the aspect of confidence. And I went ahead and had the liberty of Googling how to improve self-confidence. Right away, first page, top 25 things that you have to do, right? I'm not going to read them all, okay? I'm just going to read a couple of them. But you look at this, the first couple, this is how you build up your self-confidence. Groom yourself, dress nicely, Photoshop your image. Oh, really? 2 Corinthians 4:16, the outward man perishes, but yet the inner man is renewed day by day. But here you are. Brush your hair, man. Your self-confidence is going to be a lot better, right? They had here, think positive. Kill negative thoughts. And they give you the examples for it, too. But you sit there, whatever things are true, whatever things are honest. Those are the things that we think about. And these guys, what the world, they're like trying to usurp things that are out of the Bible. I'm going to skip a few of these. There's actually one that's like, get to know yourself. All right, yeah. How about you just get out of yourself and get into Christ? All right, this one. Number 8, this will be the last one. Be kind and generous. And they ever also qualify with, oh, so corny. If this is too corny for you, move on. But for the rest of you, know that being kind and generous with yourself and your time, blah, 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 blah. Sorry. You act accordance to what? The golden rule. You have it's called like a Zen Buddhist page, and they're having you go to the golden rule. You rip-off artist. You go be nice because that's what the Bible. Why don't you just say? Why don't you just go to the Bible? But you have the world out there that wants that self-confidence, and what they're looking is about the flesh. And Paul says that we don't glory in our flesh, right? We don't put any confidence in our flesh. Who do we put our confidence in? Christ Jesus, right? And that's who we try to have magnified in our body and in our lives. Dear Father, just thank you for this time that we had together to go through your word. And I pray that that we can take the profit out of that and be able to utilize it in our life and when we go back home. In your name we pray. Amen.